Hey, welcome to my private show, and I've also got my co-host David here, and I've also got Jesper, and we have Jason in the background. We're going to be talking about my outlook, my summer outlook for the United Kingdom, first of all. Which I'll start now, unfortunately I don't have any drawings or anything for this, but here we go. For June, I expect June to be the best month for some of the weather across the UK. I think we'll see temperatures getting up to about the mid to high 20s after mid-months, as we will have a slightly unsettled spell around the middle part of the months, but generally it's going to go down as a mainly dry, warm and sunny months overall, and I hope everybody's enjoyed the weather so far this month. I'll also for July now, I expect a north/south split. The northern half of the UK will see generally more unsettled conditions and also cooler, where frontal systems from low pressure that comes in from the northwest will produce outbreaks of rain at times, and also some sharp showers with hail and thunder mixed in from the Midlands southward. So for the rest of the UK, we can expect the dry and warm conditions to continue on from June, with temperatures easily could be around the mid-20s in July for these areas. For the north, I forgot to say about the temperatures. For the north, I'm talking generally between 14 and 18, possibly getting to 20 as a maximum, but generally cool for July. Beyond July, I expect things to break down dramatically to a much wetter, cooler regime during August. So I'm actually expecting a few flood events to occur. Where these flood events occur, I don't know yet. I'm certainly going to work on that, and I'll certainly touch upon, I'll give you more details on that during my next climate show. So, but at the moment, I expect June to be the driest and warmest months. July to be a bit in the middle with a split going on, and August to be the coolest months and also the coolest months of this summer. So, I would like David's thoughts and also Jesper as well. So. Hello guys.
Yeah, hi Lee, and good to be back again, and the weather scene appears to be changing very fast for your side, Britain, Scotland, and even here in Australia.
Yes, I'll actually come to Australia. I think I'll maybe mention Australia just now, since you brought that up. Australia is going to turn much wetter as well over the winter season down there, particularly along the east coast with the first major rain event just upon us, isn't that right, David? Just a pause here.
We have a severe weather warning currently in place for the entire area south of Gladstone to the New South Wales border. We're looking at some significant rainfall. The Queensland Weather Bureau has already issued a flood watch, similar to south of the New South Wales Queensland border, and possibly today or overnight, the New South Wales Weather Bureau should issue their first severe weather warning. So at this stage, it's within my region.
Yes. So as we've been mentioning in recent days, there's been the first major rain event on eastern Australia, where 400 plus millimetres of rain is possible. So, and I'm sure that the weather service there will be keeping a very close eye on it. And have these warnings been issued already, David, or they be issued?
Lee, what I'll do, I'll just...
I'll get you to show them, actually.
Alright, well, I'll bring up the screen share. I'll just show you what's
going on. Get you to show what's for it, yep.
Yep, okay, here we come. And it's good to have Jasper here too, and I look forward to hearing what he has to say about what's going on over his area. Okay, tell me when you've got the screen share.
I've got it here. It's not the stream yet, but I've got it here.
Okay. The Brisbane Weather Bureau has issued a severe weather warning for damaging winds, heavy rainfall, abnormally high tides, dangerous surf for the entire area south of Fraser Island. The warning is for the southeast coast, parts of the Wide Bay, which is the Fraser Island, Maryborough, Harvey Bay, the Burnett, that's inland from Maryborough, down through rural areas. The Darling Downs, that is to the west of Toowoomba, the Granite Belt. And that was issued at 7 a.m. this morning, and I think they might have updated. So, on the screen, synoptic situation shows a strong upper trough moving into the southern interior of Queensland today, shifting into a southeast Queensland. So the strong upper trough is tracking, I think, southwest, northeast, easterly, and then moving off the southern coast during a Sunday. However, it's actually going to be a clash of two systems. You've got the upper trough, and then we've got a service trough, which will deepen to the north of Fraser Island up to Gladstone, or Wide Bay during Saturday. A normal weather pattern shows that service trough lows do develop around the southern edge of the Great Barrier Reef. And then the Bureau is saying a low pressure system possibly to develop and slipping southward, which would make it parallel to the Queensland coast during Saturday. And then most likely adopting a south-south-east track away from the Queensland-New South Wales border. Then a moist easterly wind flow to the south of the surface trough, expected to combine with the upper feature to generate heavy rain, which may lead to flash flooding over areas southeast of about Harvey Bay to Toowoomba to Warwick. Now, just quickly thinking about the warning area, it's a similar pattern to what we saw back in 2000 10-11.
Yes.
When the entire area was under a severe weather warning, and we had that wall of water come down through Grantham, which is just at the the foothills of or the bottom of the range, the Toowoomba range, and that's where it just came down through the town and completely slammed into cars and pushed the cars into each other. So
I'm going to add to what David's mentioned here, and as David says, it's going to be a similar pattern to 2010-11, because as we all know now, we are now heading into a La Nina event, which I expect will be a multi-year La Nina. And I do fully expect, not just for the rest of this winter for Australia, but also the summer. Next summer is also going to be very wet indeed. And it's very good news for David to get this rain, but it's not very good for the people, because the floods that they are going to get are going to be life-threatening. What would you like to add to that, David?
Well, when I cited this severe weather warning and the area that it's covering, it brought back memories to the 2010-11 severe weather event. And La Nina is definitely coming in strong. Now, for our viewers, Jasper there and Lee, that is the current 12-hourly rainfall pattern for the Queensland. Now, I'll just zoom in a little bit. So that's the main activity. Slightly west-southwest, central Queensland. So all of that, I think, is going to track towards the coast. So that is for today. And this is updated every 12 hours. Now, we go to Saturday and look how the picture changes. So the brown is 5 to 10 millimetres. Then you've got your yellow.
Right, your light green. I apologise, dude, I did cut off there from laptop there. So, we're back up and running now. That was an error there. I forgot to plug in the charger there. Anyway, carry on, dude.
No, well, we've got you. That's the main thing. So you've got your yellow to the light green to the dark green, the green. Then you come into the dark green, and so 50 to 100 millimeters, and then you've got your blue, 100 to 150 millimeters, and then you've got your purples and 2 to 400, and the pink. So I'll zoom in on this beauty. And that is for tomorrow. And as I mentioned, the Weather Bureau updates their rainfall 12-hourly, their total forecast every 24 hours. And what we're seeing, it's only conservative. Rainfall totals could be higher.
Yes. As David mentioned, this is a major rain event on the way. As is shown here, the darker the colours get, the more rain that there's going to be. And is that your area, David?
Yes. Now, there's Brisbane.
Okay.
That is Moreton Bay. So that's right. Moreton Bay. That island is Moreton Island. There's a historic lighthouse on the northern tip, which is Cape Moreton. Then you come down to Stradbroke Island. And Stradbroke Island goes right down to close to Southport on the northern tip of the Gold Coast. So I am now looking at 150 to 200 millimetres. And that's for tomorrow.
Which is very dangerous winds, I'll tell you.
And
what
I'll do, I'll just come up the page a little bit. Okay, Gympie. And that's Bribie Island. It's a passage. Bribie Island, very fast developing for residential. And the only way you can get to it is actually by a bridge. Now that goes right up to Caloundra, which is the southern tip of the Sunshine Coast. And the commercial shipping, just briefly, the shipping channel comes close to Moreton Island, then it comes in towards the eastern edge of Bribie Island, then it goes up to Caloundra, and then the ships go out into deeper water. But Bribie Island, there is a break between Caloundra and the northern tip of Bribie. There's a very dangerous passage, but no boats can get in or over. So that is, there's too much sand. And Lee, it's part of, or just another item in brief, the erosion eventually is going to chew away the northern tip of Bribie Island. And it's going to open up. It was going to allow the ocean to come in.
Yeah, that's not very good
to
either.
The passage. No, so that's something that is developing. So I'm expecting the Weather Bureau to issue flood warnings. I think the Sunshine Coast will be the first area to see flood warnings, because they only need anywhere above 65 millimetres to see a flood warning being issued. So in coming out, I expect the number of warnings to be put. Now we go to Sunday.
Yeah, let's see what happens on Sunday. Oh, it's gone. It's just
yep. 24 hours.
So it's a 24 hours main event.
Yep.
Which is going to be definitely life-threatening.
Go on.
It seems to be that it transfers further south. I'm seeing Bollywood there. See at the bottom of your picture there. Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Well, what we'll do, we'll just come back up to Queensland, the state map.
And there's not much there at all.
And I can't do that. I'll have to click in the national and come into New South Wales. And that is for Sunday, but we'll come back to Saturday.
Yeah. I think it's Saturday. It's to be the bad day, really bad day.
There you are.
Yeah. So There you have it. So if there's any viewers that are living in Australia, please heed the warnings and please stay safe. So that got you there too.
So just continuing, then I'll bring up the total rainfall picture. What I will say again is that the entire east coast of Australia will be impacted on by this developing system anywhere south of Gladstone to the New South Wales Victorian border. Now, this was issued yesterday afternoon at 15:18 p.m. EST. This is the flood watch for New South Wales, for New South Wales northeast inland rivers, river valleys, coastal river valleys from the Queensland border to Port Macquarie. Now, I'll just bring up that. So, New South Wales border right down to Port Macquarie. Now, this area is under more threat because there's a lot of rivers and streams. And it doesn't take much for that area to flood. So, we're looking at anywhere up to 200 millimetres, and as I said a few minutes ago, it could be worse, higher.
Yeah, but that's
for bad. Yep, and that's for Sunday, Lee. You see how it tracks down the coast?
Oh, that's Sunday's forecast, right?
Yep, that's Sunday's forecast. Now we go to Monday, and look at this. It's changed. So, we go back to the national map. And we come down for the area south of the New South Wales border. And that is for Monday.
Yeah, so it is. It's a way that's transferred the way
to the south. Down the coast.
Yeah.
And even now impacting on the entire, the whole state of Tasmania.
Well, the bulk of the state of Tasmania will be badly affected in the next few days, which is early next week. So, people of Tasmania, if there's any viewers around watching, please stay alert and heed the warnings when they're issued, and make sure you're prepared and keep safe from this major rain event.
Yeah. Lee, what do you think this one is?
Now, this one is rain as well. This is a purple. This must be just next week.
That's the total forecast of rain for days 1 to 4.
Well, looking at the purples, we could be seeing over 300 millimetres, possibly 400 millimetres of rain. I'll say this again, this is the first major rain event of the east coast of America, of Australia, sorry. And I will say this as well, this is not going to be the last, this is just the start of what's to come over the coming months and possibly the next few years as well. So, I have to thank David for showing this this evening. So, hope all viewers from Australia have listened in this evening and taken all the information in.
So, that is day 1 to 8.
Well, look at that. Yeah, it's very concerning. to say the least, David, and I really hope that everybody really takes the warning seriously and prepares, but sadly there'll be people out there that don't, but I just hope
they do. Yes, unfortunately it's human nature, and with the weather that's currently taking place over there in Texas, where emergency services have had to undertake swift water rescues, our emergency services over here in Queensland, they will most likely now be on severe weather alert level 3, and the Queensland Emergency Services Fire Rescue, and they had this alert system, so I think they couldn't be on level 3 or higher, which would be level 2. So this is the rainfall for the next 1 to 8 days. And Lee, we might bring Jasper in and
I'd like Jasper to
see what his thoughts are on this developing system. And perhaps Lee, as we said, the La Nina is definitely making itself known here on the Australian continent.
So, Jasper, we would like your thoughts now and what we've spoken about so far. On you go. It's your turn.
Yes, first of all, with your summer outlook there, I can definitely agree on that. It looks like June will be the best one there. And then, looking at the Australian scene, I was following that low pressure a few days now, and it's really quite powerful for this time of year. And it looked like it could be, well, almost definite, it could be some severe flooding there. And it's a very broad system as well. So can also looking at some thunderstorm activity as well, with that cold front that comes through the north side. So considering how El Nino has been causing very dry weather over there, I think they should need it, considering how dry it's been, but maybe this isn't a bit too much in terms of rainfall at the same time. I think it's rather interesting, and we will see now. I think, when should it arrive? Tomorrow, I think.
Yes, that's right, yep.
I'll bring the wind shear up and I'll just quickly.
It's into Saturday their time, Jasper. So that's very good thoughts so far. I'm concerned for the Australians on that east coast, as I've said. So what's this, David? Is this the
wind shear, Jasper? I'll get you to comment on it, mate, and I'll bring up the other one. So, wind shear, look at the values.
Yeah, there's really high values there you can see between them. And right, I think it's hard to see, but I think I can see the center of the low is over Australia there. And it's going to move. The center is remaining fairly stationary. But since it is a clockwise spin, it's going to bring all that moisture from the north and then bring it to the east there. So yeah, the coast, mainly coast, is going to have it a real tough time.
Okay, I know, Jasper, I know you like this one, and
this is a good one. I like this one myself as well.
Yeah.
All right, you can guide me. So we're looking at the 1,000 MB.
Yeah, you can click on Earth, left click. No, it's surface. 1000, there you can see the different pressure. Basically, how strong the wind is on different heights, which is 850 millibars would be 1,500 meters up in the air. And you can see the different 700 millibars and even goes even higher. 250 is where the jet stream is, if you want to look at that.
Oh, yes, that's right.
250?
Yeah, that's the jet stream.
Oh
my goodness, look at that.
No look wonder, yeah. When you have got that strong of a jet stream, all the energy gets transferred into the low pressure, and that's where they get all that energy. So at this time, even more with the La Nina, the southern hemisphere jet stream is really powerful.
It's right over Australia. I can barely see Australia just now, ladies and gents. As Jess was explained there, the jet is so powerful, it's just going to keep giving low pressure systems for Australia. So
there's another one
there. Oh, there's another one to the north.
The trough there. And the jet stream is what gives, as you know, warm sea surface temperature is what gives hurricanes and cyclones their power.
That's right.
And the jet stream is what gives extratropical storms their power. And that's what we've seen with all the storms in the UK this winter.
Well, the winter just gone, yes. I think the next winter's going to be different, though. Because we've now got La Nina coming in. And I'm just going to mention this real quick, Jesper. Next winter, I think, will be much colder compared to the last winter just gone. I think last winter just gone was record warm due to the El Nino, and it was very stormy. But this time, I think there'll be a few storms, but I don't think there'll be as many. I think we're going to want it much colder here coming into the UK and also Europe as well. Particularly, it's going to be really cold for Scandinavia, I reckon, as well. Next winter as well. I will touch upon more on this on a later show, but I just thought I'd give you that wee brief insight just now.
But yeah, also you can see there that David is showing in the Caribbean there, and I think right there, I think we have our area of interest there in the Caribbean, and right there where it is, it is low amounts of wind shear there, more south it is, and around there, and it's basically nothing. So that subtropical jet is going to pull north, and that's going to allow that shear to decrease. So it will be interesting what path this low will take.
Yeah, well, it could be possibly a tropical storm calling, possibly over the weekend or early next week. So, I thought I'd mention that.
There is well at 1,000 millibars, you can see.
Oh, there's Bonnie.
Yeah, Bonnie there.
And I do believe just recently I've actually heard that that Bonnie's a possible tropical storm again. That should be advised in the next advisory, should be up next.
Reconnaissance mission found an even lower pressure than the advisory says at 1,006 millibars, the lowest. So I suspect there will be a tropical storm by next advisory.
Yeah, it's definitely a tropical storm again. Yeah. Definitely. Okay. Well, I see the jet stream a wee bit higher up there.
There also you can see where Bonnie is, and Bonnie basically sits between the subtropical jet stream and the polar jet stream, and when there is a big difference between those two, you can get pockets of low wind shear, and that's where tropical storms can form, in this case Bonnie.
Yeah, And what I will say as well is over this hurricane season, wind shear is going to be significantly lighter compared to recent years as well, as La Nina helps to produce an active hurricane season. So I expect a fairly busy season ahead. Will Colin be the first hurricane inside the season? We will see in the next 5 days, 5 to 10 days. So stay tuned and we'll keep you up to date.
This winter we actually had also a record low temperature, I think it was in the north. And so yeah, even with the El Niños, we might can still have low temperatures.
Oh yeah, pretty interesting. Definitely. Oh, like definitely.
That was in January. That was the only was time there. I think it was around when Alex formed at the same time.
I think it was. Yes, unfortunately, yeah. That was the only time during that winter that happened. That winter mainly went down as a warmer than average winter, unfortunately. But as I said, I think things are going to be much better and much different come the next winter. I think you would agree with that, Jess, was that right? Agree with kind of a better winter, next winter, even.
We can only look at history, you know, in predicting that and going by the biggest winter I've ever experienced was in 2010-2011 winter, which... I was walking in over a meter of snow.
So. Oh wow, yes, well that's something. But as I said, I don't expect a record warm winter again next winter. I think it will be significantly colder. But I'll touch more on that later, a later show.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you mind me can screen share? David?
You can screen share now, Jess, but yeah. Can you stop screen sharing for a second?
Yep, I'm just about to do it.
And we can let Jesper have a wee shot at screen sharing.
Yeah, and we have, if it is it up?
Yes, it's up, yeah.
Good. This is the anomaly chart going by the anomaly temperatures going from January 1st to June 1st. So far in Sweden, and overall it's a bit warmer than average. It's during these first 6 months, we'll see what happens later as La Nina develops, because it takes a bit of time for even with La Nina, El Nino usually remains in the atmosphere, so I would expect around October going forward that will really start to cool down a bit more. But anyway, going with the later part of May and into June here, we've had really warm temperatures, and these are some of the temperatures we had today. And the hottest temperature was in the west part of Sweden with 29.7 degrees Celsius, which is if it was in May, it was almost a record. I think 32 Celsius was the warmest temperature in May. In June, it is 38 degrees. And also going forward, there is tomorrow, we have another warm day before this cold front pulls down a bit colder air from the Arctic, but yes, we can see at least 29, 27, 26 degrees. Ooh, I wouldn't be surprised if we top out with 30 or some degrees.
That's warmer than us.
Yeah.
The highest I've received this week in the warm weather is 22 degrees.
Yeah.
So. But we're going to remain fairly constant at high teens, low 20s for the next week or so. So when you go, Jess, we can continue.
Yep. And later on Saturday, that cold front pulls down and we will get cold temperature. You can see 19 compared to 29. So
oh, wow.
It's a big difference there.
Enjoy, Jesper.
Enjoy. So that will be a bit different. But as you know, one, you can't stay with the same weather forever, especially not higher latitudes. And continuing forward, we will have more normal temperatures going forward. There can be some bit of warming later on next week, but overall, continuing forward, it's a bit better than we've had today with 26, 27 degrees. And because we've had pretty dry weather as well, and that's really drying up.
Yeah, that's correct. Listen, yeah.
We have a very dry weather, so you can see the amount of dry and where there is risks of forest fires in the red here. There is a very high risk of starting a forest fire. But overall, tomorrow it's going to be a bit more red and overall orange. But then as a cold front passes over with rain, it's going to be a bit better. So yeah, we've had a pretty dry end of May and into early June, but we will see what happens as we go later into June and into July.
Well, as we all know, the summer solstice is coming up on the 20th of June this year. That'll be the highest point that the sun will get to in our skies. So from there onwards, all the days will start to shorten again. Very slowly to start with, but they will speed up later on into the summer. So as Jess was kindly showing you, it's dark and the daylight signs are there.
As you can see in the very northern tip of Sweden, how the sun never goes down. It stays over the horizon here.
It stays here the whole time, doesn't it?
Yeah. And as you can see here, is a solid dark line. And there's where if you're above that, you technically don't ever have a night because you will still have twilight.
Yeah, well, as you can see, Britain's in twilight, so... this is not my most favourite time of the year, unfortunately, but I prefer the darker days than this, because it's the earliest sunrise now is 4:30 in the UK, so...
More like this?
Yeah, it's more like that, just, but I just don't like summer days at all, but yeah. Yeah, it's just my preference, but yeah.
And look at Australia!
Yeah.
Sunlight.
Yeah, that's good you're doing the day just now, so. Yeah. That's great, that's good that you showed that.
Mm-hmm. It's pretty nice. But yeah,
I do like that,
man. Yeah, it's pretty nice, and also they've upgraded another thing. Let's see if I can find it. Here's another thing, if you look at your town or wherever you live, you can see, you click on sunrise and sunset, you can see how the sun is up every day of the year.
Oh, yeah.
And you can see how long the day is and more. Like you can see here, you can solar noon, for example, in the 3rd of June here. You can see here it's 23.8, and that's basically how high the sun is over the horizon.
Oh wow, I think that's the peak there, isn't it?
The peak is on the 21st, of course, and that is 24.9, so 55 degrees or so above the horizon.
Yeah.
But it's, I wouldn't love to live in the higher north latitudes, where the sun never goes down, and even worse during the winter months where the sun never goes up.
That's right, yeah. Well, as I'm also going down to Spain in about 2 weeks, just under 2 weeks' time. So I'm going to be feeling very hot conditions, of possibly temperatures near the 40s. Once I go down to Spain, I'm going to southern Spain. Because the sun's up so high, viewers, it means that the UV levels are very high indeed, and you must wear sun cream and also a sun hat during the middle part of the day.
UV levels today was just about 7, which was...
That's about our average, actually, for the summer.
For us, and I think it should be, it says here, sometime 30 to 60 minutes maximum.
Yeah, so you would definitely need sun cream in Sweden just now. Definitely.
Luckily, I'm not outside too often.
No.
But yeah, it's. I was also going to show this.
Yeah,
covered on.
Yeah, we're going to run for another 8 minutes, and then we'll be going for a quick break. So we'll let Jesper continue to show a few things here, and then we'll. For the break.
Let's see, I'm going to show the simulated IR, and here you can see it doesn't look much as a low anymore, but as it develops, you can see how it spins up, and you can see this whole band here. You can clearly see a center here, and this whole coast here gonna get a lot of rain. As we can see, at least here in the total precipitation, it's a lot, like David showed. Can you up to, let's see, this model says 175 millimeters or so in the I think Brisbane is here, so be at least close to that area.
Yes, definitely. Very serious rains ahead during the next 24 hours or so.
Yeah, I think it doesn't look too much now, but it will look at it anyway. See if I can pull it up.
See.
Australia region.
Okay, David.
This one there. This is right here, but this is the sensor located right here, and here's the rain bands. So we will see as it develops.
So as you can see, Jesper's very kindly shown some different images of the severe conditions that are developing in Australia on the eastern coast.
Yep.
So I'll need to look into these models, actually. That's a brilliant image.
Mm-hmm. That's from the Himawari 8 satellite. That's from the RAM site.
Yeah, that's fantastic. So, as I was mentioning to the viewers, Australia is going to be getting much wetter over the winter, but also into the following summer as well. It could be conditioned similar to 2010-11. For Australia, so I'll keep you all up to date as on my climate show of events there as well. But back to Europe and the UK, what's this?
Yeah, this is tomorrow at 12Z.
Just temperatures, yeah.
Yeah, temperatures, you can see 27 there and 22, and it's already starting to be a bit colder in the UK. I think if you look at the jet stream, would be a better. Yeah, it's very disruptive at the moment. But it will start to get colder as it colder temperatures down.
Yeah, I think we have to be duller tomorrow, so it'll be a bit cooler.
Let's see. Yeah, here you can see this cold line here comes down. So it'll be a bit more refreshing, I guess, going forward. So you won't have these, you know, ridiculous high temperatures. at least,
no.
Like this, I think this temperature anomalies come around 14 at some spots. So
Yeah, well, as I mentioned, June will be the Britain's best months of summer weather. I expect a breakdown in July, where it'll be just a kind of two-way split. The northern half will be more cool and more unsettled, while the south will be drier and a little warmer. And then as we move into August, I expect a much wetter regime across the entire UK and significantly cooler as well. So I expect summer to end with a very cool and wet note. Back to you, Jesper, for the moment. Just my thoughts, really.
Yeah, and you know, it's, at least it's better than last year's June, which was very cold.
Well, it was very cool. Yeah.
I think it was, pulled that up, 2015. This was June for us, and you can see mainly very cold, like day, the 15th, I think it was, 10 below average. So,
what a difference a year makes, eh?
Yeah, and I think it was I think it was a bit of a funny thing. I think it was Midsummer's Eve was warmer than Christmas Eve in Sweden.
Oh, wow.
It just shows you
viewers that conditions can be different from one year to the next. And Jesper's shown that beautifully there. June last year was a very poor month, not just in Sweden, but also across the UK as well. But this year, it's the other way round. It's a fantastic June, fantastic summer the weather. So please enjoy,
So, just some January, I suppose. It was the 6th of January when the record low was set. And basically the hole was purple. This scale only goes to minus 10 below average. But even, I think it was set north here, was around here. The cold, I think, was 40-something Celsius minus.
Oh my goodness, that is freezing.
Yes.
That's like a double freezer.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So
interesting to, it's very, you know, it's very different from the equator, sorry?
Is that the name, isn't it?
It's about 15 or so, I think.
It's not bad.
Might as well go in and check it. Let's see if I have it. There we go. 14.9 as of
Well, we're going to be stopping now for a 5-minute break. After that hour, we will be back for the next hour. So if Dave could very kindly put us on to a 5-minute break, that'll be lovely. Fire away, Dave. And we'll be back in the next hour.
You're watching Force 13's live streaming service.
Hey, can you hear that? The sea in the background washing in here on a fantastic beach in Australia. Force 13 AU. We're going to be talking about weather, storms, and everything else that's Australian-based in the world of weather and storms.
Tune in to Force 13 Australia every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday at 11 a.m. Australian Eastern Time.
Hello and welcome to Force 13's Live Hangouts. As you can see, my name's Nathan Foy, and today, at least for the first minute, I'm upside down. I'm joined by my fellow upside down friends, Craig, hello.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. I'm upside down.
Fantastic. Daniel, hello.
Hello.
And the noise is coming from John.
I can't go upside down, I'm sorry. I'm
if you spot a blooper on the Force 13 channel at any time this year in 2016, watching the 2015 bloopers right there, send us a message to our usual mediums and make a note of which point, at which time that you saw that blooper and in which video it is, if it's already one that's online, and we'll consider it for the 2016 blooper reel. Oh boy, here we go again.
And welcome back to the Climate Show, where we have Jesper and David and Jason. So in this second half of the show, we're going to be talking about the earthquakes, and we'll mention about a wee bit about Yellowstone as well. So I'm going to bring up the live earthquake. I'm just going to put the screen chain on, so bring up the latest earthquake map, done. That's it. Start moving this down a wee bit. So, just recently we had a 5.1 earthquake over the Fiji Islands. But most recently we had a magnitude 6.5 magnitude earthquake in southern Sumatra yesterday. The good news about that one is there was no tsunami warning or anything like that, but it was quite deep, and Jess will know a wee bit more about the deaths than I do, but it was definitely quite a deep earthquake. It was an undersea earthquake, magnitude 6.5 from yesterday. Hold on, why is that not shown on the stream?
Might have to refresh again, Lee.
That'll be neat to be said.
Oh, there we go. I think it's...
You got it?
Is it on the stream? Hold on a sec.
Yes,
I'm just going to restart the screen in a minute. So.
Better do that.
Sus. Right.
Okay, we've got it.
Right, you've got it. Sus.
I think.
So, as you can see, I'll give it a second to come up the stream and then I'll, because it feels neat to see it. That's us. So, as you can see, we are currently having quite a few earthquakes currently at the moment. By looking at these regions, orange regions, it looks like the one that, with a magnitude 2.0, just in northwest France, 14 hours ago, most recent towards the UK, but the most severest ones are in red. And as you can see, we've had a couple very close to Yellowstone, just to the south, in California, magnitude 2.6, magnitude 2.1. But in recent months, since late April till now, we have seen numerous major earthquakes in places like Japan, Indonesia. I think there was also a big one near Australia as well, and also a couple in the Fiji Islands. The most severest ones were in Japan and Indonesia, with a magnitude 7.5 last month, and also the magnitude 8.1 also at Ecuador. We're actually two magnitude 8s at Ecuador in the past months during May. I'd like to get David's thoughts on some of these just now. What do you think, David, of the numerous big earthquakes that we've seen since late April?
We definitely have seen a spike in major activity, and we had a couple over to the north of Perth. I think it was around magnitude 4.8. It caught the eye of the Joint Australian Tsunami Warning Centre. But the activity has really increased. Jasper, your thoughts?
Yeah, your thoughts too.
Oh, it's really interesting how it has, you know, where, first of all, how earthquakes are so unpredictable and you don't know where the next one will strike. And these ones are pretty interesting, especially those, you mainly focus on those that are close to Yellowstone or around Yellowstone, because we all know it can be pretty nerve-wracking how if we get a pretty powerful one there.
Well, we actually did actually, let me jump in there, you said that there. We actually did a magnitude 5.1 just 2 weeks ago at Yellowstone. Mm-hmm. And that's actually the biggest one recorded this year at Yellowstone. Before that, we made more magnitudes 2 and 3 earthquakes. I mean, and Yellowstone is producing about 200 earthquakes a day. But the magnitude 5.1 is the biggest one. And what these earthquakes are indicating is the magma underneath the massive caldera at Yellowstone is starting to rise upwards. And as it does so, the ground also rises at Yellowstone, and it also makes the geysers more violent as well, with the steam that comes out of them. I might very briefly show you Yellowstone during this live event just now, if that's okay. I think we'll go and do it. I'll do that just now.
While you're doing that, Lee, after that, I can fire up my screen share, I have some video footage that, it's up to you. I can screen share and I can...
You know what, you can show the video in a wee second. Yep. Okay. I just want to let people see a general look here of Yellowstone. And the geyser that you're seeing right in front of us with the people, that's called Old Faithful. And that's one of the biggest geysers in Yellowstone. But Yellowstone has about 300 plus geysers at Yellowstone. Most of them are small, but there is a few big ones, and Old Faithful is one of the biggest ones. At the moment, Old Faithful is steaming, but it's generally quiet at this time. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to ask David to show his video of... I think you've got a video of that, haven't you, of Old Faithful, David?
I've actually got a few, Lee, but
yeah, well,
I've
like
got one ready
show,
to go when you...
Yeah, I'd like you to show one where the old paper's actually going off, so... hold on, I'll stop the screen share a sec. I'm going to hand you over to David so you can show his video. So fire away, David, when you're ready.
Okay, wait a minute.
Okay. This,
this is another
geyser which is situated behind quite a forest of trees there. But this is a most recent video that we were that me and David had taken while doing our individual show. Me and David do regular updates on Yellowstone, so please stay tuned to Force 13 Extra for regular updates on Yellowstone National Park. So I'll let David mention what we're seeing here. What do you go, David?
There's no doubt that the activity is increasing. A particular note, Lee's comment with the number of events over the period of time that Lee and I have been monitoring the Yellowstone feed. We have seen, in our opinion, new events fire up. This one we saw probably about a week ago or 2 weeks ago, but I do have recent ones. So when this one finishes, about 5 minutes, I'll bring up another one of Old Faithful and very close shot by the staff there at the National Park Services. And it, this one really showed how clear Old Faithful was, a really close proximity to the vent.
Yes, so what's basically happening is that activity is increasing, and Old Faithful and all these other guys just beside the tree, especially this one, are getting more active as well. I would also, can I say something, David? I would also like you to show the, see that bit, picture or video that you took of the two stars. So I'm going to reveal the answer to the bottom star if you've got sorry?
I haven't got my fingers on the video. It's here.
Have you got it though?
I haven't got the video at my fingertips, fingertips, but what I do have that photograph that
well,
I can bring
up. Well, even the photograph,
up.
You can bring that up, Sid.
All right, well, what
so
I'll
I
do,
I
can bring it up now.
Okay. Oops, went away again.
Yeah, it's all right. I'll just stop the video and we come into that.
Now, so as you can see here, David has circled two stars in yellow, as you can see. But this was actually during the night, about 3 weeks ago or something, David.
Yeah, it'll be about 3 weeks ago, Lee.
Yeah,
and, see the old faithful there.
So, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to reveal the answer that we gave to the viewers for the bottom star tonight. The bottom star is in fact Planet 7X, Nibiru, the bottom star. And Nibiru is a planet that comes in and out our solar system every 3,000 to 4,000 years. It's got a constant orbit, and what it will do is it will cause major events on the Earth as it passes the Earth. It will pass the Earth again sometime next year or the year after. But what will happen is we will get more and more earthquakes on the Earth. We'll get more violent systems, and we'll also see a pole shift, which is currently underway. A pole shift as well. And we'll also see a meteor shower with this planet as well. So I will be monitoring things, but that is the answer to that. The bottom star is planet Nibiru. So thank you very much indeed for the image, David.
Jasper, what are your thoughts when you're looking at this? But I've actually seen this on two occasions, but I actually do have a video that I took of that this picture isn't as clear as the previous one. And the first one is definitely a lot brighter, say.
You don't have access to that one?
Do you have it with your belt?
It'll take me a few minutes to locate, but we can bring that up on our next show. Yeah, but it's something that Lee and I are finding interesting. There are a few videos on the YouTube channel, not ours, but other YouTube channels. But it is food for thought. And any viewers, if you'd like to post a comment, we'll see answers.
Yeah, but what we will do is that in the next show we'll reveal the answer to the top star. I'm still currently searching that, so we'll have all that answer as soon as possible. Jesper, I'd like you to talk about the deaths of earthquakes a wee bit, explain that to the viewers.
With the, you probably all heard about the magnitude. There is nothing, nothing new really, but every so often you also hear about the depth of the of an earthquake, and that is basically what where in terms of depth in the crust where the earthquake happens, and the further up in the crust and the closer to the surface an earthquake is, the stronger and closer obviously the vibrations will be to the surface, and that can actually cause more destruction. And so even if there is a magnitude 6 earthquake, if it is at a very close height to the surface, let's say 5 kilometers, or even smaller, it could cause some destruction as well. Like the Japan earthquake that was very strong, that one occurred at a depth of 30 kilometers, which is about average or so. They usually occur a bit more, around 80 or so, but the smaller ones, like if you two or even weaker magnitude, they usually around 1 or 2 kilometers, because the smaller ones are usually the ones that are not very deep down. But yeah, that's the thing you gotta. Got to keep in mind as well about the depth, that it has a big effect on where the damage will occur.
So thank you very much for that fantastic insight into the depths of earthquakes. I'm also going to mention that Scotland did also have an earthquake in the past 10 days, and that was a magnitude of 1.5. It was on the western side of Scotland. It was at a place called Oban, people reported it and wondered what it was, and the news came up and discovered it was an actual earthquake. So We don't tend to get, we tend to get the very small ones, but they're not very common in the UK now, as what they would have been millions of years ago. Because millions of years ago, Britain used to be very volcanic, particularly around Scotland and some parts of Wales and Northern England, because Scotland used to be like Iceland. Scotland used to sit where Iceland is today, and that's why Scotland was so active back then. But nowadays it's now Iceland that sits there now, and Scotland's got no active volcanoes now. So yeah. So anything else you'd like to add, David?
I was just thinking about the local scene over here in Australia when it comes to earthquakes. I was thinking of tornadoes, so that's different. But as I said previously, the earthquake activity is, it's spiking again. But one question I would like to ask Jasper, from your observations, are the earthquakes getting deeper or shadow earth? Were you trend? Is it trending up or down?
I think it stays about the same, but I would say the frequency is increasing and the magnitude. But in terms of depth, I don't see any change at all.
I'd like to leave it up.
It can occur in different different parts. I never had seen that before, for example, but that's about it.
And recently we did have a couple of earthquakes in the Northern Territory of Australia as well,
which
did measure magnitude 5.3 and magnitude 5.0 as well. I don't think they caused too much damage, did they, David?
I haven't heard of any reports. Jason, over there on the west coast of Australia, he said to me that they normally occur to the north, the Pilbara, the northwest area. And there was one in the Northern Territory, as you said, Lee. I think it might have been near Uluru, Airswak, or around Alice Springs, but there hasn't been any reported damage.
Yeah, that's good news. At least there was no damage or anything like that. So, but as mentioned here, the biggest earthquakes were through Japan and Indonesia over the past months or so, and Ecuador, not forgetting Ecuador, that measured a magnitude 8 during May as well. And very sadly, it killed about 600 plus people, so that was probably the worst disaster during May. And also another very important point on Japan, the earthquake even split Japan, Southern Island, even split that into two as well. And it also shifted Japan about a foot as well to the south as well. So
that caused Japan to, sink down a bit into the ocean.
It has, yes.
Yeah, and if that would not have happened, would not have been any flooding, because I think the tsunami was exactly the height that was these sea walls could protect them from. I think it was a few meters or so. I think it was, because Japan shifted downwards in the ocean a bit, it was just enough for the sea to pour in.
So yes, Japan has moved a bit of foot, and as Jess was mentioned, it did a lot of flooding in. So, but in the last few years, Japan had the worst earthquake in history, which was a magnitude 9.0, which did occur on the east side. You've got another just live there.
Yes, provide some rolling.
So we are currently seeing the current activity of Yellowstone. And this is Old Faithful, I think. Yeah, Old Faithful.
The one to the back. What are you noticing when you're looking at? Is something shaking?
Well, you see the camera shaking, Jasper. I'm going to tell you what that means just now. See the shaking of the camera, that's due to the earthquake activity that's currently happening underneath Yellowstone at this time. And currently at the moment, there's actually a magnitude 3 earthquake going on underneath Yellowstone at this present moment, so that's why we're getting the shaking on the camera. Just for the viewers as well. So, as I was saying there, we keep blasting each other, don't we, dude? As I was saying, this is actually the back geyser behind Old Faithful, and this geyser has actually been becoming more active in the past 3 weeks or so, and it gives off quite a show, we'll pass you back to David now.
While we're looking at the activity over there in Yellowstone, we do invite feedback from the viewers, and you can post to the chat, or I'll go one step further and say you're always welcome to provide feedback via our online contact page on the Force 13 website. There's a feature there where you can post feedback, and the email address is there. So put your thoughts to us, and it will be directed to the hosts of the various shows.
So I will currently let you all know as well. Me and David are also doing live updates, regular updates on Yellowstone through our own little show, if you like. We're doing regular updates, and we'll be posting these update videos onto Force 13 Extra, so please tune in to Force 13 Extra as well to keep up to date with Yellowstone. But what I will do as well also for the climate show, I'll also mention Yellowstone at times during my climate show as well, just like tonight as well. So back to you, David. Any more thoughts, you two, yes?
Thanks, Lee. I'll just cancel the screen share, and I'll have a look for this close-up of Old Faithful.
Yes, that'll be much appreciated. I'd like people to see Old Faithful close-up as well. Before the end of the show, we'll end the show in about 15 minutes' time. So if anybody's got any questions and for this about the climate or about what we've discussed here tonight, please send them in to us to our various media contacts.
Okay, Lee, here we go. I think this is one of two.
Right,
I think so this might be the main one. Now, you just look. Hang on, what are we done?
You haven't done anything, it's just playing the video.
Yes, I just, I think this is the one. I know I've got to, so this
is also a very good image, a latest image of Old Faithful at its finest, viewers. This is when it's at its most active at this point in the day. This, in fact, was last week, I think, David.
Yeah, it's pretty close to it.
Yeah. So me and David will be continuing to monitor Yellowstone as mentioned as well. So what do you think, Jesper, of all places?
Something that just, you know, goes on 24/7. So
thank you. Also, as you can see, there's also smaller guys that's going off at the same time to the left of the video as well, on the video's turned. At certain points in the day, we also see all the guys just going off all at the one time as well. That's also another indication that Yellowstone is reawakening, and an eruption is definitely on the cards at a future date, which I am currently currently looking into with David.
So you can actually see you see the activity, and a lot of these have fired up in recent days.
Yes, they have indeed. At the moment, Yellowstone is feeling quiet just now. But great footage. I'm going to bring that back up if you stop there. I'm going to bring up the latest image now of Yellowstone. So we'll go back onto it. Switch share. And here you are. Here's right now at Yellowstone for our viewers. So any questions at all, please don't hesitate to ask them. And the comment section. So, so as you can see, I'm currently busy.
I have another couple of minutes from another one, but I'm still
trying to make the other one.
So,
yeah.
When you're ready, my friend.
Right, David's got another fantastic video to show you. So I will stop the screen share, and you can find me, David. So, Yellowstone is one of the biggest volcanic volcanoes in the world. It's classified as a super volcano because the volcano is basically the whole park. There's a lot of people that won't know that, but that's why I'm mentioning that to the viewers just now. So, I'll let David explain what he's showing you.
Now, this is further to the left, and you can notice how powerful this one is where I've got the, pointers showing up. So this is just further activity, but you can see see how much activity is going on. But it has been very quiet the last few days.
It has, but it will go through quite a spell and then it'll be active sometimes, and etc. So, I have to say, fantastic imagery that David has got here, so we've got to thank David here for that, and David will continue to get further evidence of this as we know the experts there have turned off the monitors at Yellowstone, so the general public cannot see what's really going on. So me and David will continue doing updates. So, thank you, David, for that. You any further comments, Jesper, at all?
Not at the moment.
Not at the moment, that's fine. I'm just going to screen share the logo behind it just now. because next 5 minutes or so we will be ending the segment show. So I just want to mention the UK weather forecast for the next few days. And it is looking generally dry. And fairly sunny too, apart from some fair weather clouds. Temperatures will persist in the high teens to low 20s, but also we may see the mid 20s in some of England during Saturday, Sunday, and possibly Monday as well. I'm not ruling out the possible odd 30, possibly in London late next week. But generally, as we approach the middle part of the month, we will start to see a little bit of rain, a little bit of thunder showers, scattered thunderstorms due to the energy of the sun and also due to the warmth that we've been experiencing so far. So I will keep you all up to date on the latest weather, etc. What's happening. So I'm going to see if Jesper would kindly screen share the temperature map again. Is that okay, Jesper? Just screen share that for us. We just don't mess with you first. That's us. I'm just going to get Jesper to screen share the UK, looking at UK temperatures as well.
It's at 12 UTC Saturday. It's mainly the
Here we go.
This east, the UK that will have the warmest temperature going forward. Towards Sunday, you can see 24 here, 23.
Yeah, so it's definitely going to be peaking around Sunday, with the mid 20s here.
Monday also a bit more.
Quite warm, more widespread on the Monday. As mentioned, we are going to see thunder showers as well. Later on in the week as well, as we have a lot of energy within the hitting the earth at the moment, as we are now in the summer, so there's been a lot of instability, and there'll also be higher Kate values as well, to indicate that there's going to be thunderstorms mixed in with the scattered showers. I expect the thunderstorms to be mainly in southern Britain, but I'm not ruling out the odd thunderstorm or two possibly forming across Scotland, as we have been having a bit of warmth this past week to 10 days or so. So I expect, even if we don't get the thunderstorms, I think we'll get heavy thunder showers with hailstones mixed in. So generally, I expect next week and also into the week after to introduce us a little bit of unsettled weather with sunshine and showers, and some of these will be on the thunder side. And then after that, I expect it to turn much drier again for the rest of June, with it possibly turning into a good 2 weeks or so of nice sunny and warm weather until July. And once we hit July, I think it'll start to downhill for the north, as I've previously mentioned just shortly ago, that we will get a bit more unsettled in the north and it will remain dry in the south. Temperatures in the north between 14 and 20, and for the south, we're expecting 20s up to possibly a 30, possible in London in the second half of this month. No, not set after this month. I set after this month, sorry. Start up. And once we're into July, I expect a two-way split. Once we end July and go into August, we're going to see a detailing racing, which basically means it's going to be a complete breakdown for the whole UK this time, where it's going to be reducing much cooler temperatures and much wetter conditions, and I do expect a couple of flood situations as well. Temperatures generally dropping down to below average for the summer for the UK. So I expect temperatures to fall down to the teens for the bulk of the UK during August. Perhaps the odd 20 here and there during the drier and dullards, but basically dropping down to the teens generally. So I wouldn't be surprised to see perhaps some snow in the highest mountains of Scotland during August as well, which can happen in late summer as well. So what's this just for you, Jesper?
This is the jet stream level right over the North Pole. It's hard to see, but here's North America, and here is Europe, and here is Asia.
Right.
So we got over here. I'm just mainly looking at what the jet stream are going to do, if it's going to pull. Maybe weak. Yeah, it's going to be mainly weak over Europe. Not doing much.
It should stay mainly south of the UK this month. As I've mentioned, a lot of dry weather. But I expect when we get to August, it will start to come over the UK or even above the UK and produce that unsettled weather that I have mentioned as well. I just want to jump in there, sorry Jesper, I'll let you carry on.
It's fine.
Yeah, so is this a temperature map now, or is this a...
temperature map.
Temperature map, right.
In Celsius, by the way.
In Celsius, so that's the whole world this time. And as you can see, there is severe heat in the Far East there, and also across Russia. There as well. The heat, it seems to be much weaker across the United States, which is rather interesting as well. You would expect the United States to see severe heat by the midsummer period. Yes, it's here. When's that for, Jasper?
That's for June 10th.
But at the end of the week, they could see a very hot spell across the United States there, which is definitely worth keeping an eye on, because we may see another tornado threat further down the line as well. If that.
Yeah. Also, just wanna check one last time here what the
Oh, that's excellent, Nathan. And,
well done, Lee.
I'm just going to run to the end of this.
I'll watch it here around here. See about the jet stream. Yes, you can see it's here, white here, so the slow shear, and here's as the jet stream sits, and it's gonna pull north, as you can see, and pull that system.
So I have to say, the show is definitely getting the viewers this evening. I have to say, this has been a terrific show. We've got 10 minutes to run, so if you've got any questions to answer that you want answered, then you can find a way to let this be 10 minutes of questions and answers.
And As viewers will be able to see a repeat of Lee's show. As I mentioned previously, and I know I'll be speaking on behalf of Jasper and Lee, if there are any viewers that have something relating to the climate that would like to have discussed, send a message through to us via our contact link on the Force 13 website, and Lee and I and possibly Jasper will have a look at it, and we're always looking for content across the platform. And Jason and I over here in Australia, we have a Force 13 AU channel ready to be activated. But as Lee said, we also have Force 13 Extra, which the members of the team can upload. So. We're definitely looking for membership, content, graphic designers, and more content. But for me personally, it's been a very good show to be part of.
I do agree, it's been a terrific show this evening. Jasper, what's this for them?
Here is the last video I just want to show from the 27th to 30th of May. There was reports of a very significant thunderstorm in the central Europe, and this is just a satellite animation of those. And as you can see, during the day you can see those thunderstorms building up. So we had a quite powerful mainly in Paris and Germany as well. We've heard about that flooding has been as well.
Right. Yeah.
So here you can see as the video goes by, and you can see how they build up during the day and during the evenings. They really get powerful. And
I will mention this too. There has also been tornadoes across Europe. As well, because some of these storms were supercells across Bulgaria, Hungary, Germany, France, and also down over Switzerland as well. There was a little one as well recently. But the thunderstorms have been very, very severe across Europe due to the fact it was very hot over the past week to 10 days across Europe. These thunderstorms have very sadly caused very severe floods across France and Germany, and sadly we have lost life. So we needed to hold a thought for these people in France and Germany this evening for that. That's sad news coming from there tonight. So on you go, Jess, what's this?
It's just another temperature map globally, and then we just pulled up.
Right.
As you can see, it's just the tomorrow, and you can just zoom in on Europe just to show it. It's going to be our last warm day here with 25 or so or more temperatures in the south, and yeah. then after that, the cold front will pull down. A bit more normal temps tomorrow, on Saturday.
Yeah.
So it will be a bit more.
Yeah.
More pleasant.
It'll be more pleasant temperatures there for Scandinavia, yes.
Yeah.
And also the UK as well, but not till after June. We'll get better temperatures as well. But our temperatures will remain above average until the end of June. And then once we go into the two-way split, that'll be Scotland, though that'll be below average during July. and England will be above average along the Wales and Ireland. Northern Ireland and Scotland below average during July, and we're also going to be below average for the entire UK in August. So Scotland will actually have 2 months below average. So generally we're looking at it's going to go down as a mainly cool summer for Scotland in particular, despite the warm June that we're having at the start. So when you would guess.
You would like to go to Antarctica instead?
Oh, imagine it. Imagine going to Antarctica.
Oh, minus 60 I'm seeing there.
Oh, that'd be beautiful, imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know another member called Adam would love to be in a cold place right now, viewers. Because he cannot cope with the severe heat in the Caymans. I really do feel sorry for Adam down there sweating himself to bits. So I also look forward to seeing Adam again. Adam, when he was back to the UK later this year. Well, we'll be doing a little bit of camping when he comes back. So I thought I'd let the viewers know that. That was great. There, Jess, for what you were showing. What else are we showing yet?
No, just checking with that in the National Hurricane Center studio.
Before we finish, I'm going to mention the tropical scene just before we finish this evening. So, the tropical scene this evening is we do have Tropical Storm Bonnie, which has been developed. It was initially a tropical storm last week when it made landfall. We've got an update on the tail. I'll go to that in a second. Bonnie actually has killed a couple of people during its first passage over the Southern Carolinas through the north. As it left, it weakened down to a post-tropical cyclone, but it very quickly has actually come back up again, and a Raycon Air Force plane has confirmed this this afternoon on the east coast of America. So we do have Tropical Storm Bonnie once again. Hold on a second, David. And we also are looking at a possibility of a Western Caribbean system, which can you bring up now, Jesper?
Yes.
We're also looking at a possibility of a hurricane coming from Colin, but due to the fact that we're getting very warm waters, temperatures up to about 31 in the Western Caribbean sea surface temperatures. But this system also is going to be having light wind shear as well, which is going to allow development of a possible early season hurricane within the next, by the time we get to early next week we could start to see that possibly happening, but I think we'll be seeing a tropical storm in the meantime. From this, and as you can see, the chances in the next 5 days is 40%. But I expect that to rise as the days go on. I expect that to turn red, that circle for the next 2 days or so. And do you want to see it just for a quick at the top?
Sorry?
Do you like to mention what they're showing here?
Yeah, this is just they call out a broad low pressure area, and right now is, I can just show it on the frames here, it's located right here at the moment, and it's starting to spin up, as you can see in the last frames, it's starting to get that spin to it. It's not going to develop too fast, too quickly, but it's as it moves very close to this coast here, the lowest located somewhere around here. It moves around to the West Caribbean slowly, and it's around when it enters the Gulf of Mexico is when the NHC thinks it will starting to develop to a TD or greater.
So what I will mention is that should be in the 93L tomorrow or the Saturday. We should start to see something there. I'm also going to mention 91E as well, which is in the Eastern Pacific. I don't expect much from this. I expect a kind of moderate to strong tropical storm from this system. The system has got a moderate chance, I don't think it will come to much as we expect the Eastern Pacific season to become significantly quieter this year due to the La Nina. So if we do get a hurricane from this, I will be very surprised indeed, folks. I'll let Jesper say a little bit about it now, and then we'll wrap up this evening's show. So, how do you go?
This disturbance monitored by the NHC was today, so the latest update lower from, it was initially at 90% in the next 5 days, and at 70% in the next 48 hours, but was indeed lower to 60% and 80% in the next five days. And as we can see, it still remains disorganized. Might have zoomed in a bit on it. Let's see. There we go. It remains a bit disorganized, and it's mainly because of wind shear. It's not very good environment in terms of sea surface temperatures. It's good, and moisture remains decent, but wind shear remains not very good over the system. It could be better in the next 3 days or so. It could be a bit better for development, but at most I would expect a high-end tropical storm from this.
Yes, as I said, thank you very much for screen sharing there, Jesper. What we're going to do now is we're going to be ending the show, so I'm going to be thanking David, Jason, and also Jesper for their participation this evening. My next show will be cancelled in the next 2 weeks, as I will be in southern Spain for the holiday down in the province of Almeria. So my next show will be in about 3 weeks' time. So we will have it around 2200 UTC once again for that week. So thank you very much to Jesper, Jason, and David, and also the host of the project, Nathan. So thank you very much, and have a very good night. Thank you, Nathan.